Chief executive, broadcaster, mayoral candidate, cabinet minister, you can't say John Tamihere hasn't had a varied and colourful career. But a quiet announcement last week could theoretically put him in one of the most powerful positions in New Zealand. John Tamihere was elected unopposed as the new president of Te Pāti Māori at a time when the debate over the relationship between Māori and the Crown has a new intensity. Tamihere knows all too well his party could hold the balance of power at next year's election. John Tamihere, tēnā koe, good morning. Unopposed.
Well, we opened up nominations and a number of the electorates just came back with knowing I was standing. And so that was quite pleasing to be voted in by acclamation.
Why do you want to be president?
I've had more in my generation, I've had more yesterday's than we're going to have tomorrow's. And so what it behoves us to do is put in place succession management. And Kahau te rangatahi is the Hone Waititi saying in his great educational book that he wrote in the 60s. And what that says is it's for the older fishermen to hand over the nets to the younger ones to go fishing, to bring home the food for the tribe. So what we're doing and what you're seeing across the whole of the Māori nation, for the want of another way to put it, is that succession and handover to people like Rāwhiti Waititi and them, who are the first out of the gate from the promise of the flourishing of our Kōanga Reo movement. And so that generation is now playing a significant role and will continue to.
Okay, so to be clear, you're one of the older fishermen in this.
No doubt about it.
In 2019, you applied to be a member of the Labour Party. And when you were denied, you attempted to take legal action, or at least considered it. So what has changed between wanting to be a member of the Labour Party and being president of Te Pāti Māori?
Well, you've got to look at all the toolbox that are available to advance your people's interests. And the Labour Party is merely one tool in the toolbox. National is. ACT isn't, probably. It's a fucking shocker. But put that to one side on Māori-related matters. So Labour was an opportunity to shift the whole conversation after 9 years of a very grey government under John Key and Bill. And Bill English, outstanding, don't get me wrong, but very grey. And so we had to change the dial up. And between 2017 and 2019, it was quite an important conversation in our world.
Okay, yeah, but you applied to be a member of the Labour Party. And when they denied you, you considered taking legal action.
Oh, yeah. I will litigate if things are unfair. And I've had a very good result in terms of success in litigation.
My point is that you were so keen to be to be a member of the Labour Party that you considered legal action, but now you're the president of Te Pāti Māori.
Oh, yeah,
so I'm wondering where your allegiance actually lies.
No, well, my allegiance lays to my best interest of our people. And so, like I said to you, it doesn't matter what tools in the toolbox, you've got to reach the best tools to achieve the best results for your people. Now, I was made a member of the Labour Party when I was 8 years old. There were only two tribes those days, National and Labour, and Dad was in the Labourers' Union, and he enrolled me and my eight brothers and three sisters already into the Labour movement. We have that embedded in our DNA. Breaking away from that and liberating myself from that is also helpful.
Has this government done a good job supporting Māori?
This government has done a good job, right? And you shouldn't be churlish. All governments do some good things. But the problem is, if I could give you one example, when you vote $11.1 billion into the health system, and then $540 million of that is tagged for Māori, you're actually building in the inequality that we already had in the previous system. And so we've got to have more grown-up conversations that if Pākehā people are allowed to deliver services to Pākehā people, there's this apprehension that if Māori are delivering to Māori, there's something wrong with that. And that's just not right. And so Māori Party policy has been successful in regard to the rise of the Māori Health Authority. And you'll see the innovation and the initiative there change the dial in mainstream for the good.
Just to be clear, as president, can you be a candidate as well?
Oh, you can be. Look, but as I said in your introductory question, we're endeavouring in my age group across the whole of Māori leadership to changes occurring. Ngāhi Wī Tūmuana down in Kānunu, shifting to another generation of leader. And it goes on and on. So I'm merely part of helping that.
So just to be 100% clear, are you going to stand?
Well, I don't know that at the moment.
But you might.
We might, yeah. And we'll work our way through.
You might.
Yeah, that's a strong possibility.
In Tamaki.
Possibility. Jim Anderton did it, and so did a bunch of others.
What are the seats in which Te Pāti Māori has the best chance of defeating Labour outside of Wairiki?
Yeah, well, Wairiki will become a fortress seat. What that tells our people that a vote for the Māori Party is not going to be a wasted vote this time, as it could have been in 2020. Tamaki Makaurau and Te Tai Haururu are definitely marginal and very tight marginal seats. And so we stand great chances in those electorate seats. And we're very much an electorate party as opposed to a party vote party. And a lot of Pākehās don't know that they can vote for the Māori Party. They think you have to be on the Māori roll. But that's not true, and you start to see that in some of the polls.
OK, I'm just interested in your strategy here, because I know you are a keen political strategist. Mm-hmm. So where do you think is the best chance that Te Pāti Māori will win one of those seats? Hauauru?
Oh, no doubt Te Tai Haururu and a tide going out on Labour, and it is.
Yeah.
It's the extent of it.
Tamaki as
well. Tamaki, no doubt. And then we have our eyes firmly fixed on Tai Tokerau as well.
Okay, who's going to stand in Te Tai Tokerau?
Oh, well, look, the electorates have yet to confirm and run the beauty contests that achieve the candidate. Last elections, Kapa Kingi, Maria Menua, Kapa Kingi is an outstanding candidate. No, I wouldn't be worried if she won the candidature again.
What about Honi Hanawira?
Honi has had some personal issues inside health with the family, not him, and he's committing to his whānau and to the setup of a lasting system up there.
I called him the other day. This is a bit cheeky of me, right? Yeah. I called him. Do you want to know what he said?
No.
I said, too bad. I said, Hone, would you ever stand again? And he said, quote, never say never. And I said, what do you think of the current iteration of Te Pāti Māori compared to the one that you were previously associated with? And he said, quote, I think they're doing an effing brilliant job, a lot more organised, a lot more focused. And I said, do you get along with JT? And he said, like a house gets on with a fire. I don't know what that means necessarily, but if Horne was open to it, is that something you would consider?
Oh, well, Horne knows he has to put his nomination in and run the race like everybody else. I'm not here, as a party president, I'm here to build a lasting organisation for a movement that will never go away in this country. It's Indigenous based and it will continue. So Horne was part of that journey in putting that in place.
Right.
And big ups to his wife too. A lot of people don't appreciate that. He could not have achieved what he's achieved without Hilda.
Debbie Ngāre Wepeka and Dawiri Maititi made it clear to us when we spoke with them last that they would not work with National in any future negotiations around the shape of a government. Are you of the same position?
We don't know what's going to happen. Under the present policy settings of National and particularly ACT, it would be very difficult. And that's what Rawiri and Debbie are saying. But here's the thing. Let's have a look at how the cards settle on election 2023.
I know there's a lot of water to pass under the bridge, but I know, as I say, that you are a keen strategist. So what would be your approach if Te Pāti Māori, in just over a year's time, finds itself in a position where it can decide the shape of the next government? How would you go about that process?
Oh, no, I'm not prepared to discuss that because I've just been elected. I need to have conversations with our national executive and we need to go back to our people on the street and the electorates to work out a due process if that eventuality ever occurs. It will always occur with third parties that can tip major parties into government. But inappropriate at this point in time of my presidentship to embark on that conversation.
Do you have a position as to a shape of government that you think would be most effective in progressing the status of Māori in New Zealand?
Oh, look, the present travel of the present government is most helpful to that.
How do you mean?
Well, National and ACT oppose a Māori Health Authority, notwithstanding all the evidence is screaming that it should occur. National initially opposed Matariki Day with ACT. So, you know, everywhere that there is a positive Māori program, National and ACT leadership use us to be demonised as Māori people.
But do you think it's more effective for Te Pāti Māori to be outside of government?
Well, look, I don't want to express my personal opinion now that I'm the president without coming into some communion with colleagues to be able to express that. And I'll be, while I'm, I do write a number of opinion pieces, my opportunities for hit outs on programs like this will be diminishing dramatically because Rawiri and Debbie hold the mana to do that.
I want to ask you about Te Whanau Waipareira. Yeah. You've been on the front line of the COVID-19 response, and of course there was a lot of attention on your organisation throughout the vaccination program. How is COVID-19 affecting the Waipareira community at the moment?
Oh, look, our main operations are out in the west, okay, and that's from. Oiraka Mount up at Mount Roskill going west up to Helensville. And so, like all populations in this country, they're deeply exhausted, and over it. And it's just how we transition our people back into some form of new normalcy or whatever that might look like.
Are you seeing whānau reinfected?
Yes, and the major vectors for that are the children. Because of our low pediatric vaccination rates. That didn't need to be that low, but our babies are now that we can cuddle our mokopunas and what have you, a lot more transmission is occurring, both of flu as well as COVID.
Are policy settings as they stand appropriate given the risk that COVID-19 still poses, even to vaccinated communities?
Well, we've got to get through this winter, okay, and we always set targets out on our street. That we've got to up our sanitation and hygiene over the next 90 days to protect the more vulnerable. And that's what we do. And people say, masks are hopeless and that. Well, they're welcome to that, but we will mask up, right? And that's what we ask of our people. And we ask of them to use sanitary product that we are providing, sanitizers and the like. And so as long as you continue to provide public health jolts, strong public health messages, because our people can't afford all the luxuries that others take for granted in middle class New Zealand. Yeah, so we have to roll out a whole range of hygiene packs, etc.
Well, some critics say the government has effectively given up on COVID-19. Do you have a position?
Oh, I think they know that middle New Zealand is over it and deeply exhausted as we are. But a number of populations can't protect themselves as well as middle class Kiwis can. And middle class Kiwis take it for granted that everybody lives in their value system and their world, and that's just not true. And that's why we exist as the Māori Party, but also whānau Waipareiras of this world exist. And we're really pleased to serve all our communities. Yeah.
You took legal action last year in the High Court to access Ministry of Health data around unvaccinated Māori. It took a big effort to get that data. What difference did it make in the end?
We were able to identify now going forward how to plan. For instance, we have a major looming problem in the whole of the country with children who are no longer engaged in education because they've been out of the system for 2.5 years. Those babies need to be sorted out in regard to being brought back into some form of training, skills or education. Otherwise, we have a gang problem and it's increasing, but the government knows, or the state agencies know, and that's one of our biggest problems is underperforming, overpaid bureaucrats. So our problem is we've got to get ahead of that curve rather than wait for the train wreck and then pick the pieces up after it. So the beauty about our data analysis and the like and our reach into that has allowed us to plan on the street rather than wait for some bureaucrat in Wellington to tell us 9 months after the event we should do something.